This is an eTalk special event.
From Brad and Matt to Jen and Kate, the world's biggest stars have come north for the Toronto International Film Festival. But amongst all the glitz and glamour, one steely cool standout has emerged. What's up, and welcome to the John Lennon fully loaded educational tour bus. I'm your host, Saul Guy from For Real, and I guarantee you that inside this bus is something you ain't never seen before. And also, this is something that John Lennon not only would have been proud of, he would have loved it like I do, and you will.
I'm very, very proud of it, very happy about it.
Yoko Ono, Natasha Bedingfield, and will.i.am are just a few of the artists who've climbed on board this mobile studio.
I'll take time and come from the back studio to hang out with the kids and get the vibe going and talk to them and, you know, just see what they're bubbling about up there in their brain.
The traveling studio gives students all the tools to create their own video and music projects with help from some of the biggest names in the biz.
So many kids, it's going to be their dream. And I got my start in the studio because some of my friends had, you know, a little home studio, and they let me come on and just get involved. And that's the best way to learn.
And now some Toronto students are getting a chance to learn with the bus park here at CTV's festival headquarters.
Art and music are two things that are so important for people and for children especially.
So check it. CTV gave 7 students all-access festival passes so they could capture the glitz and the glam, the drama, the razzle-dazzle, everything through their eyes.
This whole experience has meant a lot, like a great big deal. Like, it's a really, really big event going on right now. I actually decided to take a few days off of school for this.
I think it's a very, very great opportunity, and I hope my little brother, my little sister, everybody that I know from where I live gets that opportunity.
Now, giving them some help along the way were industry pros like Julie Black, Chaos, Luther Brown, and none other than Oscar-nominated director Jason Reitman. In 2006, Montreal-born Jason Reitman secured his place in Hollywood with his first feature, Thank You for Smoking.
We don't sell Tic Tacs, we sell cigarettes. And they're cool, available, and addictive. The job is almost done for us.
But it was last year's box office hit Juno that propelled Reitman to new heights with a Best Director Oscar nod.
Hey, big puffy version of Junebug. Where you been?
Just out dealing with things way beyond my maturity level.
I've directed a film that's nominated for Best Picture. I can't make sense of that in my head. That's reserved for films like The Last Emperor. Like, I'm not supposed to be in that group.
Known as the little movie that did, Jason's Juno introduced us to Ellen Page, Diablo Cody, and brought in over $220 million worldwide.
Did you see that coming?
Yeah, but I was hoping she was expelled or into hard drugs.
Or a DWI? Anything but this.
Next, this Canadian superstar may be teaming up with George Clooney for the film Up in the Air. But first, he's here with me, and we're teaming up with our Lennon Bus student.
We're gonna go inside, they wanna meet you, and we wanna see what they're cooking up. You ready?
Yeah, let's check this bus out.
All right.
This is a badass bus.
What was the most important thing that you've learned that has nothing to do with film that has had the biggest impact on you in film?
Ooh. That's a big question. This is day one, huh?
I get paid to talk.
What do you talk about?
I speak on behalf of cigarettes.
My mommy says cigarettes kill.
Now, is your mommy a doctor?
No.
Well, she doesn't exactly sound like a credible expert now, does she?
This is going to seem like a really generic thing, but it actually impacted me enormously as a filmmaker, and that's to be true to who you are. And the reason why it impacted me as a filmmaker is that when you want to make art, you have to figure out what type of art you are a fan of and what type of art you want to make. And it's very easy to think, oh, I'm a big fan of that art, so that's the kind of art I'm going to make. So let's take movies, for example. I love the movie Die Hard. I've seen Die Hard a million times, but I'm not going to make Die Hard. Die Hard's not the type of movie I was actually born to make. I was actually born to make another type of film, another type of film that I like a lot. But I think that's an important lesson to learn, because you could sit down and say, well, I love Die Hard, I want to make Die Hard. I also love Ferris Bueller's Day Off, I want to make that.
Bueller. Bueller.
I love Charlie's Angels, I want to make that. Like, there's so many different types of movies that you could love, but it's very important to find out who you are and what your voice is and what story you were supposed to tell, or what song you were supposed to write, or what movie you were supposed to direct. Because every time you're trying to tell someone else a story, it'll feel like lying. And you have to figure out what your story is.
What inspired you to create the social issue films that you do?
What we need is a smoking role model, a real winner.
Indiana Jones meets Jerry Maguire.
Right, on two packs a day.
I think it's that most of the social issue films that I see are always telling people what to think. And I don't like that. I like movies that really leave it up to the viewer to decide for themselves. And the point of a movie like Thank You for Smoking was that you should make decisions for yourself, that we don't need our government to parent us, that we're smart enough and capable enough to make decisions on our own.
If we want to talk numbers, how about the millions of people dying of heart attacks? Perhaps Vermont cheddar should come with a skull and crossbones.
What I liked about the screenplay for Juno was that it didn't really ask you to take a side on teenage pregnancy. It viewed the situation as just one girl's real decision, a human decision. So I guess that's why I like to make the films that I kind of do. Comedy is about socially relevant topics.
That ain't no Etch-a-Sketch. This is one doodle that can't be undid, Holmes Gillett.
What role does music play in your creative process?
Music's huge for me.
You're a part-time lover and a full-time friend.
For any movie that I'm ever thinking about making, I have an iTunes library that's ever expanding. As I start to make the movie, I give that whole library to my editor, and she starts cutting the movie to those songs before I even get into the editing room. So music fuels me as I write. Often, if I'm not in the mood to write, that's the only way I can get into the mood to write. You know, I had a collection of songs when I wrote Thank You for Smoking that, no matter what was going on in my life, whether, you know, I was in a really bad relationship actually at the time. I had this ex-girlfriend and she was really mean. And it was really hard to get in the mood to write this kind of joyful character. And I had a series of songs that I could put on and I would just listen to them in loop and would put me in the right mood to write a particular type of scene. It's so easy to get distracted and the dedication to kind of sit down and write can be really tricky. So music, I think, really helps that. And it sets the tone for the kind of moves you make.
I need to know that it's possible that two people can stay happy together forever.
The best thing you can do is find a person who loves you for exactly what you are.
After the break, Jason opens up about his father and imagines a better world.
Imagine if there was a pizza. It had pepperoni on it. It tasted really good.
And later, Julie Black keeps it real with a serious heart-to-heart.
The only way to get to lower those walls is through your mind and through your dreams.
Yes, yes, what's up? Welcome back to this special edition of eTalk. I'm your host, Saul Guy, and this is the John Lennon Educational Tour Bus. And this bus is packed with the greatest technology in the world. And it gives students an opportunity to create their own music and films. Now, when creating your own music and films, what better cat to give you some insight than Oscar-nominated director Jason Reitman?
Do you draw from personal experiences when you're creating a film?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, my daughter was born 2 months before I started directing Juno. So I was making this movie about parenthood and how it affects this young girl who's pregnant, the young boy's gonna be a father, and also, you know, Jason Bateman and Jennifer Garner's character who were about to become parents themselves. And I was going through that experience. I was going through actually all four of their experiences all at the same time.
I'm pregnant.
Who was the father?
It's Polly Bleeker.
Polly Bleeker.
I don't know how I could have made that movie without having gone through that experience. I would have just been guessing.
Who's someone that inspires you?
My greatest inspiration is my father. My father's my hero. I went to school and I went pre-med and I thought, I'm going to be a doctor. I thought, I'm gonna try to be a doctor, because no one ever questions why you become a doctor. No one's ever like, oh, doctor, you know? and I was failing out of school. And I'm like a smart guy, but I was failing out of school. And my father came to visit me. So my dad said, Jason, look, there's no more noble a profession in the world than being a doctor. If you became a doctor, your mother and I would be over the moon for you. But I don't think there's enough magic in it for you. I think you're a storyteller. I think that's what you were born to do. And you can't be scared of it. You have to follow your heart. And so that's what I did.
Everything I am is due to my mother and my father. The man that I am, the father that I am, the husband I am, the filmmaker that I am, we'd be here for years.
We're so proud of you, all of us.
What advice would you give to keeping your dreams alive?
To follow what's in your heart. it's really easy to get misguided, to wind up on the wrong path because you're fulfilling someone else's dreams. If they're your own dreams, it'll actually be very easy, because when they're your own dreams, you can't help it. It's what's in your heart. Your gut naturally pushes you to do those things. And if you find yourself losing interest in them, or if you find yourself not having it within you, I think you have to really examine the dreams and make sure that you're own. They're your own.
Do you feel that this has been effective in the past, or do you think that it just sort of stirs up, well, look what they're doing now, and what do they hope to gain by it?
It's an incentive for other people who are interested in promoting peace to think of other ideas, whatever they are, to get peace on the front page.
I'd like you to imagine for a second. If you could put any lyric or series of lyrics in front of the word imagine to make it your own, what would you put? So, imagine.
Oh, man, come on! I'm like doing all right. I'm answering the questions.
I told
my big inspirational story. Now I need to rewrite the song Imagine.
I'm
one of the greatest songwriters of all time. I'm like, imagine if there was a pizza and it had pepperoni on it. It tasted really good. Imagine if we stopped hating each other for what we believe. Imagine if we had enough confidence in ourselves to think for ourselves. Imagine if we stopped telling other people what to think. Imagine if we had more of a sense of humor about all things. Imagine if we didn't take things so seriously and we could just have conversations about things and laugh about things. I think that's probably why I make movies, is to make people laugh. I think we do take things too seriously and we get in arguments. Comedies, for whatever reason, open up people to talk about things. I made a movie about cigarettes and I made a movie about teen pregnancy, and in a weird way, if they had been dramas, I wouldn't have been able to say the things that I could say.
Your parents are probably wondering where you are.
I mean, I'm already pregnant, so what other kind of shenanigans can I get into?
If you could pass on one thing to them, you know, what would that be?
You've got to find out what your voice is. And that may not happen immediately. That's not an overnight thing. The most important thing is, who do you want to be? Everyone that you admired at one point had a moment where they stopped trying to be everyone that influenced them and they became the artist that they are. And that is why they're truly great. And I think it's a huge moment. And you just have to be ready for that and listening for that.
I just want to absorb as much as possible and meet as much people and just like have like sick dialogues and get inspired.
I always watch the film festival on TV, you know, and I could never place myself here, you know, because I don't know where I would get the opportunity from. But I guess, you know, with persistence and hard work, things do come true.
Coming up, all aboard, and some of the best in the biz step up to lend some words of wisdom.
I'm so joking. Do not soundbite that. Don't soundbite that.
What's up? Welcome back to this special edition of eTalk. I'm Saul Guy from For Real, and you know what? Jason Reitman wasn't the only star to hop on the John Lennon tour bus. So word spread quickly all over town, and soon everybody wanted to get on board.
Do you draw from personal experience into your songs? Are they what they
yes.
Do?
Yes, and every boyfriend knows that as well. It's about telling stories, so for me it's been always about personal experiences or my friends or my family. You know, I lost a sister when I was 12 years old, so I wrote about her, and I mean, Luther's a songwriter too.
That's where you draw the most experience. It's from what you went through, what you did, what you saw around you. That's like background for any type of art.
I spent my first 18 years in Finch, and I still go back to my doctor and dentist, and it's a place I'll always be a part of. But I realized that we can walk to the mall, walk to school, walk to the library, walk to your doctor, walk, where everything is just there. There's these unseen walls, right? So the only way to get to lower those walls are through your mind and through your dreams and through taking the chance, right? Instead of saving your money for a bus trip to Buffalo, don't go that month. Save for 6 months and go somewhere else.
My mind, my heart has never been so far apart.
What role does music play in your creative process?
If I had no music, I don't know what I'd do.
Yeah.
I don't know what I'd do. If I'm not trying to write a song or just
playing something to sing along with it or to make up a routine. Music is my life. That's my 9-to-5 on top of my 9-to-5.
The role music plays in my life. Music is the air that I breathe. It's language. I realized in sharing my music that you look at different walks of life and we speak music. World would be silent, like you're saying. The birds are music, the cars are music. And I think it's very important for us to listen to other people's stories that are being told through other genres.
What advice would you give to someone to keeping their dream alive?
Don't be the stereotype. When someone tells you you can't, you definitely tell them that you can. You show them that you can. And dream a new dream all the time. When that dream seems like it's taking long, dream another dream. Stay true to yourself. There's only one you. So don't let anyone clone you. Come on.
I want a picture.
We have to do our... Who's sitting down there? On three, Finch. 1, 2, 3, Finch!
This is the song that we've been working on.
I think it's cool. I think in the legacy of John Lennon, you should maybe put some guitars on it too. So it would be interesting to hear, you know, young cats as yourself with a sound that has maybe something closer to like what John Lennon would do or the Beatles, as opposed to like just an R&B sound, which is cool. But I think if the song title is influenced by John Lennon's legacy, maybe it would be cool to make the music influenced by him as well. That's the thing about sampling, I think, why it was so attractive to me in the beginning, and my father didn't like it because I was taking these records and taking pieces of the record that sounded a certain way because I didn't necessarily like the sound that was made for the radio. I think to kind of keep true to what John Lennon does, it would be really amazing if that same music, but just maybe more of a raw sound.
I totally agree, yeah.
Well, you have no choice. I'm joking. Do not soundbite that. Don't soundbite me like that. That doesn't mean you were born to die. Either way, you were broken hearted. I don't know what I'm talking about. I just like the Beatles a lot. I'm really here because I think John Lennon is one of the greatest artists that ever lived, and he stood up for what he believed in. So whether this was going to be a heavy metal bus or R&B bus or whatever bus, it's John Lennon bus. I think you guys have a wicked opportunity to meld the sound you obviously already have with something that's old. You know, it's like they say, something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue. You know, that's a basic general rule for all art. So if you borrow from all these different places, your thing's gonna sound like so. It's gonna have so much dynamic. Yes.
Right. Definitely. Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
So after all that inspiration and advice, the kids hit the streets to put their skills to the test.
How you doing, everybody? This is Carl Anthony Humphrey. I am standing here with the very, very talented and famous Farley Flex. He's managed for Maestro. He is also one of the judges on Canadian Idol. Welcome, Farley. How you doing?
I'm very well.
How do you know who or what is the next big hit? You know, the next big artist, the next big song. How do you know?
Well, you know what? It becomes instinct after a while, but generally what I look for is something that has all the common denominators of previous hits, but adds another level of uniqueness. You know what I mean? So you might hear a song that has a particular bass line or a particular rhyme scheme or whatever it is, or melody, and it reminds you of something, but then there's a nuance about it that makes it sound unique that you could say, wow, this could be the next thing.
Well, why don't we go into the bus? Come along. We're gonna go take a tour of the bus. It's quite amazing, actually. We see all these people, they all wanna get on the bus. I know they do. Come along. What's going through your mind? Like, how you feel about the studio?
It's very, very impressive. Like I said, you know, to bring opportunity to people who have interest but may not be able to connect with people in the industry, I think it's a really wonderful thing. This reminds me of Canadian Idol. Because Canadian Idol, what we do is we do the same thing. We take the show to remote parts of the country where people from all walks of life and all geographic circumstances can come to one location, audition for the show, and we help them make their dream come true. That's what you guys are doing. To have a tour bus that will go across this country and impact people in a hands-on way like this, and then teach them like it with state-of-the-art equipment, that's phenomenal. I'm in full support.
I want to see where I fit in. Like, I want to see what I was meant to do. Because I could do a lot of things. Like, I could do, like, editing, I could do music and stuff, I could do, like, graphics and everything. I just want to see which one, like, I'm the best at, and then work on that, incorporate the rest, and just do something major.
I'm looking forward to tonight. Meeting some celebrities, never got an opportunity like this. I live in Jane and Finch, and where there's a lot of people living there that's only living in the neighborhood, don't have the chance to go out. So this is a great opportunity, and doing a major event like this is great.
This whole experience of being on the bus kind of enhanced my experience of being like a film artist. It's actually the first time I've been involved in anything to do with red carpet and celebrities and stuff, so it's pretty exciting.
What advice would you give to other students trying to follow their dreams?
Follow their dreams? Basically, don't listen to anybody else. Learn your craft, learn what you want to do, and try to be different from, you know, try to be different from the people you admire.
I'm sure you're aware of the song Imagine by John Lennon. And if you were supposed to put any lyrics after the word imagine, what would it be? Imagine.
Well, I hate to say it, but, you know, he wrote lyrics that people can live by. So I wouldn't want to change a word he said, because I think if you look at that song, it could solve a lot of the problems in this world. And it's a shame that, you know, we all can't agree on some of those lyrics.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
Bye. I got Steve.
Wonderful, wonderful. You guys are super, super help. We're here live, the Toronto International Film Festival. If you were to contribute one line to the song Imagine by John Lennon, what would it be? Imagine.
Oh, there's many lines already been put.
What would you put?
I would put a little silence so that everyone thinks of a line.
Coming up's an exclusive, something you won't hear anywhere else. Well, that's all for now. But for more information on the John Lennon Educational Tour Bus, please check out lennonbus.org. Thanks for watching. Thanks for joining us. Peace.
If the fits hit your body, then my words hit your soul. I never sell to the devil to reach my goal.